Family Christian Center has committed passionately to pray for schools. What we do is we ask our eldership, we ask people who are members. Now I'm going beyond. I'm asking you. So if, say this was a school, and I was walking up to the school, and what you would do is you would touch the school like this. Say this is the door, and you would just touch the school like this. And you would say, Lord Jesus, I anoint this school. No shootings in this school, Lord. I am praying no shootings. Lord, I am praying no violence. Lord, I am praying that angels go into this school during the school year, and I anoint this school and believe in the name of Jesus, peace angels will be in this school. I need the name of that school because what we're going to do is you submit the name of that school, go right to our website and give us that name of the school and then your name. Then I will write the principal, the president of a daycare, grade school, private school, Christian school, public school, but I need your help. Last year we had 600 schools. We are believing for 1,500 schools to be prayed for. And every school we prayed for, there was no shooting. Do that today. Thank you.
Maybe one of the most important things I say tonight, turn the negative recording off.
Come on.
And start playing what God says about you all through the day. I am equipped. I am blessed, talented, creative, disciplined, focused, confident, secure, prepared, qualified, motivated, anointed, accepted, approved, valuable.
Welcome to Yes You Can. I'm Pastor Steve Munsey, and thank you for allowing us to be on your phone, your computer, and this television station today. Ever how we're coming to you, I want to say thank you. And today, 490 rule. 490 rule. If you have never heard of the 490 rule, it's in the Bible. It is probably one of the most powerful revelations that has ever been given to mankind. Jesus actually gave us the 490 rule. In fact, the 490 rule, when you hear it today, and I hope that you will be as excited to hear it as our excitement in this revelation that Jesus gave to us as we give it to you. The 490 rule was specifically given to us by Jesus Christ. Of course, God had believed in the 490 rule. But if you hear the 490 rule, it will change everything in your life. It is the whole basic principle of how you get to the next level financially, in your marriage, the maturity spiritually, how to retrieve your children back to you if they've strayed, in some cases that happens, or there has been somewhat of struggle mentally, of depression, of sickness, the 490 rule. I promise you that today when we go in and begin to break the Word of God and break this mystery, break this revelation before you, I know positively it will change your circumstances. So I'm going to take you right into Family Christian Center Auditorium. We're just 30-some miles south of downtown Chicago. We're on the Indiana side next to Lansing, Linwood. And for all of you in the Chicagoland area, I want to give you an invitation because I'll be speaking this morning at 8:30, 10:30, and 12:30. Three services, three exact messages, and it will be different than the revelation you're about to receive, the 490 rule. Let's go into the auditorium live, almost live, because when I say live, I am referring to the phones and the phone number that is on the screen, because we're live with the phones, with the number that you see on the screen, and that's the live part. That this is us right now as we are live, and you see that number on the screen, you dial it for prayer or for questions, and we are there live to take your call. So while this program, Yes You Can, is going forth, and you are receiving and hearing the 490 rule, this incredible revelation that will change your life and add to your life and just compel you to the next level of your life, there's a number there that we are standing live and we can take your call. Let's go now into Munster, Indiana, right on the line here of Illinois, Indiana, and go into Family Christian Center Auditorium and hear the revelation of the 490 rule.
Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector. Assuredly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them.
Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive him? Up to seven times?
I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven.
The 490 rule. The 490 rule. What is the 490 rule? The 490 rule is Jesus teaching us, as he instructed Simon Peter in the 18th chapter of Matthew, when he said, you are to forgive. Peter said seven times, and Jesus said, forgive them 490 times in one day. The 490 time rule is forgiveness. Forgiveness is the act of pardoning an offender. In the Bible, the Greek word translated forgiveness is, and it literally means, let it go. Everybody shout, let it go. Jesus taught us to pray, forgive us our sins as we forgive everyone who is in debt to us. We find that God is teaching us that if we can do the 490 rule, powerful things will happen in our life. When I talk about forgiveness, immediately we begin to think about all the people that have offended us or done something to us. And what I want to deal with today, because I want you to go to the next level of your life
And that is, I'm not worried about the people who have done things to you that have offended you. I am more interested in you being set free from those offenses. Think of forgiveness more about how it changes your life by bringing you peace and happiness and emotional, spiritual healing. In other words, unchain yourself from the person who has offended you. In this passage, Jesus then begins to say these words. Let me tell you, if you forgive them, Peter speaks up and says, what about 7 times, Lord? Then Jesus said 70 times 7, 490 times. But he says something very powerful. If you can forgive, you have the power to speak your future into existence. Here is what Jesus is saying. Anyone that can forgive the offense, you have the power to bind on earth that will be bound in heaven. And whatsoever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then he says, again, I say unto you, have two. That's the reason why coming together, I believe that everyone here today knows how to forgive or believes in forgiveness. If you do, shout a great big amen. Amen. And you will find that this is the principle of success in marriage, raising children, and in life. And I will tell you, as you go in life and as you get deeper with God, you will find many offenses will come, because the higher you get with God, there will be that many more offenses that will come with your success. Now, if you stay poor and don't have anything, nobody will ever talk about you. But you start achieving, you start getting the blessings of God, and watch jealousy and watch gossip and watch people get offended. You must overcome the offense. And you might say, how many times should I forgive? Jesus is saying 490 times in one day. Now, when we think about that, we think about that is so impossible. I mean, how can I keep forgiving over and over again? Instead of you trying to change the offender, just change yourself and let God take care of the offender. Now, I know that there is a divorce situation, and I know that there are all kinds of offenses, loaning money and them not paying it back. I know that there is all kinds of offenses that come. Jesus even gives the parable here. He talks about a man, a great lord, a king, so to speak, who has a man that owes him a lot of money. He brings the man in and says, pay me my debt. The man falls on his knees and says, please forgive me, Lord. Please forgive me and give me a chance. Please, I didn't have the money. Please be patient. The Bible says, Jesus is saying this in this particular passage. He says to the man, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to forgive your debt. Don't you know he must have jumped up and down? How many of you could jump up and down if your mortgage company, the bank, called you in the morning and said, don't worry about it anymore. We have just paid it off. Your car, whatever debt you might be in. So you see this man, now Jesus is doing the talking. After the man had been forgiven of his debt, he goes out and he has people that owes him money. The Bible says he is reckless. He forces them. He threatens them. He wants to put them in prison and holds them accountable and will not forgive them of their debt. The Bible says that when the king who forgave him of his debt found out about it, he brought him in and said, if you can't forgive others, I'm not going to forgive you. I'm going to put you in prison and you're going to be tormented the rest of your life. Listen to this, everybody. If you have unforgiveness in any way, you are tormented in your mind and in your spirit. It's time to unchain yourself, Don't play God. Let God be God and forgive 490 times. The Bible talks about that we have the power to speak it. In other words, Jesus is saying, if you forgive, I will give you the power that you will be able to speak things into existence. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Oh, we ought to do that, because I believe I'm among two or three people that really, really are more than two or three. I believe I'm a whole church of full of people here today that you believe God has forgiven you, that we can agree right now in the name of Jesus. Are you ready? In the name of Jesus, we bind inflation. Now, let me ask you, will God listen to us? Will God respond to us? Will God hear our prayer? For he said, when two agree, it shall be done. He said, if any two agree, it shall be done. I'm going to prophesy and tell you that what the Supreme Court did this last week, when they said, we're not going to kill any more babies, we're not going to allow it to be done. Everybody in this, and let me tell you something. I want you to be very careful about this. Don't you dare give a party credit. There have been people for years on their knees. We have prayed for healing, for the Bible said, if my people, which are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, I will heal them. I thank God for who stick up for righteousness, but I'm going to give all the glory to God. There's a healing coming to our nation. You ought to clap your hands and shout amen. There's a healing coming. It's coming. We have already, we have defined and said, oh God, we want to please you. Now that we have unchained ourselves from an offense, someone who has wronged us, someone that has done something to us. Now, I know that there are challenges with the one who offends. I understand the insurance policies and the lawsuits and the courts and the healing that comes from that. And God provides all of that, because the Bible says, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Now, if you're going to play God, you are in a serious position in which God will hold you accountable for all of that which you can't forgive. But I'm going to preach a good message to you today. Be set free. It doesn't matter what you've gone through. Be set free so you have the power to bind and to loose. I don't know if you want it or not, but I'm going to challenge every person. You have the power when you have forgiveness in your life. You have the power to speak to cancer. You have the power to speak to diseases. You have power to say, my children will be blessed. You have power to say, my marriage will be blessed. You have the power to say, I will get out of debt. You have the power to say, gasoline is going to come down. For the Bible said, we have the power to bind and to loose. And right there ought to make everybody just shout a hallelujah, saying, praise be to God. It is so important to understand that God has said these words. He said these words in the book of Psalms. He said, for thou, Lord, art good and ready to forgive, and plenteous in mercy unto all of them that call upon thee. Ephesians 4:32 says, be kind one to another, tenderhearted, following one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Jesus goes on and gives us Mark 11, and it coincides with Matthew, where he says, I'm going to give you power to bind and to loose. He says, have faith in God. Everybody shout, have faith in God. And he goes on and he says in Mark 11, if you have faith in God, he says, this is what you can do. He says, verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say to this mountain, be thou removed, it shall be removed, and be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart. I'm reading Mark 11:23. And those things which he saith, everybody say, what I say, it shall come to pass. He shall have whatsoever he saith. He shall have whatever he saith. He's talking about every person that understands the 490 rule. And then he goes on to say, therefore I say unto you, whatso things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that ye shall receive them and ye shall have them. That means that if you've got a desire, God says if you live the 490 rule, when you're praying, even if you don't speak it, I will look into your heart. I will give you the desires of your heart. Here comes a new home. Here comes a new car. Here comes a scholarship. Here comes a raise. Here comes good health. Here comes the blessings of God upon your life. Anybody excited about God giving you that privilege? And then he says, and we say, oh, we're so excited, Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord, that I could speak to the mountain. Thank you, Lord, that whatever I saith in the name of Jesus, oh, God, that is so incredible. You would allow me, oh, to be in a position that I can literally speak to my future, speak to my children, speak to my money. Life and death is in my tongue. I can decree a thing and it will come to pass. Oh, but stop. There's a 490 rule. Jesus says, just a minute's commercial time, before that all comes to pass, that you ask and you speak and you believe, I must tell you, when you stand praying, 25th verse, forgive if you have aught against any, that your Father also, which in heaven, may forgive you of your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which in heaven will forgive your trespasses. That means your prayer falls to the ground and nothing happens. May I tell you today that you are on the verge of the greatest miracles to come into your life. But I'm gonna tell you, you better get ready. The more spiritual you become, the more aggressive in life you become, the things that are happening in your life, you better get ready. Offenses are going to come, and you need to be standing ready to say, I am not gonna let that thing affect me. I'm not gonna let it take the power of me speaking into existence. I'm gonna get the power to speak to mountains, speak to valleys. Oh God, I want the power to speak, oh Lord, life to my situation. So Jesus then turns around and says, okay, I want to talk about the 490 rule. He goes to Luke 17 and he begins to say to his guys or his disciples, he said, I got to tell everybody something, get ready. I don't care how spiritual you get. I don't care how heavenly minded you get. I want to tell you something. Jesus is talking. He said unto his disciples, anybody a disciple, anybody a believer, he's talking to a believer. He's not talking to a sinner. He's talking to believers. It's impossible but that offenses will come. But woe unto him through they come. What is Jesus saying? Jesus says, it's impossible that I stop offenses. There are people going to betray you. People going to lie on you. People are going to do things they should not do. It's impossible. They are going to come. And then Jesus pauses and says, okay, let me just tell you about those that bring the offenses. Let me tell you about those that try to hurt you and try to do things to you. If there is no forgiveness in their part, it would be better that the one that is the tail gossiper carries on to keep that offense within them. It would be better that person take a millstone and hang it around his neck and he cast himself into the sea. Jesus is saying it would be better. You cannot live in life with an offense. It would be better for you to drown yourself than to bring an offense to someone. And then Jesus goes on, and Peter and they're standing there, and Jesus says, you must forgive. Peter then goes on, says the same thing as Matthew writes, how many times shall we forgive? Jesus then turns around and compliments the 490 rule, forgive 490 times. Then something is said here. This is a revelation. The apostles, the disciples following him said, Lord, if we have to forgive that much, you're going to have to increase our faith. Then Jesus turns around and says, okay, let me tell you something. If you have a mustard seed of faith, you might say under the sycamore tree, be thou plucked up by the root, be planted in the sea, and it should obey you. Many times I read that and thought, yes, speak to the tree and it'll be thrown into the sea. I begin to look up the word sea. Sea means, it means in the Bible, it already refers to many times that he casts your sin into the sea of forgetfulness. Meaning Jesus is saying, look, let me tell you something. He says, if you just have a little bit of faith, the sycamore tree is a crying tree. When you are offended, you cry inside. You hurt. If you're not careful, the roots of bitterness will get inside of you. Anger is like a drop of water in a bucket. Anger, anger, anger. But those drops turn into a bucket of horrible anger. Until you are frustrated and God does not answer your prayer. And Jesus is saying these words. He is saying, you have to speak to the crying that is in you. You have to speak to the hurt that is in you. You have to reach down and say, oh, sickening, crying, painful offense that that person has done to me. I speak to it, come out of me and be cast into the sea of forgetfulness. The first husband, the person that did not pay their bill back to you, the person that took advantage, the person that lied upon you. You must get used to the fact that when you are a believer, you're going to be lied upon. You're going to be attacked. The Bible says in Galatians 5, we do not wrestle with flesh and blood. We're all going through battles. But if we will live our lives on our knees to say, God, I forgive, and we obey the 490 rule, then we can speak to every mountain that gets in our way. We can fill every valley that is low and can be exalted. We speak the crooked places to be made straight and the rough roads to be made smooth. And we speak existence and we speak miracles and we speak our future and we speak our blessings. All of you awaken. You're not dead. I just want you to know, even though you might not have said anything yet, you're not dead. You're alive. This is the day the Lord has made. He made sure that you were alive on this day. That means that God is listening to some people who will say, I will let nothing separate me. I am God, I'm not going to let any offense offend me. I'm going to rise above it. Vengeance is mine. And God, I want the power to speak to my future. And somebody shout a great big amen.
The 490 revelation, as we are beginning to understand the power of forgiveness, the power of forgiveness. I am moved by this message because I know that when I forgive, I have the power to speak to my future. And today, this is what we are learning. And if you're struggling in any area, if you're a businessman saying, I'm trying to get to the next level, I'm really trying to staff my business right, I want my marriage to really be strong. My children, as they are being educated and I am raising them, or my health, I'm really struggling. The doctor said this about my health. I'm struggling mentally in where am I? Wherever you are in life, I I know for sure that Jesus is saying the principle of the 490 rule, which is forgiveness, that when I really, really forgive, and sometimes there's some moments in life it is really hard to forgive certain issues that happen in our life. I mean, I could talk about the extremes, but if one forgives, you will receive a miracle. We're going to go back into the service. I want you to hear it all. Right now, we are live. There's a telephone number on the screen. You can call it. But let me tell you, there is a email right below it. And for you that are good at emails, or if you'll take that email down, and you will say, Pastor Steve, pray for me, or Pastor Steve, I have a request. That'll get right to me. I mean, that'll get right to me. And I'll tell you, I'll take that email and I will look at it and I will see you responding to that email, and I will respond. I will respond with prayer. I will respond immediately in communication and believing what God is about to do in your life. Do that right now while we're on the air. Let's get right back in. Right here at Family Christian Center, right outside Chicago, and I'm inviting everybody to the 8:30, 10:30, 12:30, to the whole service, three services this morning, a different message, but this message, it'll change your life. It is in the auditorium of Family Christian Center in Munster, Indiana, right outside Chicago. Let's go back and let's get the whole revelation on the 490 rule.
The Bible says in Galatians 5, we do not wrestle with flesh and blood. We're all going through battles. But if we will live our lives on our knees to say, God, I forgive, and we obey the 490 rule, then we can speak to every mountain that gets in our way. We can fill every valley that is low and can be exalted. We speak the crooked places to be made straight and the rough roads to be made smooth. And we speak existence, and we speak miracles, and we speak our future, and we speak our blessings. All of you awaken. You're not dead. I just want you to know, even though you might not have said anything yet, you're not dead. You're alive. This is the day the Lord has made. He made sure that you were alive on this day. That means that God is listening to some people who will say, I will let nothing separate me. I am God, I'm not going to let any offense offend me. I'm going to rise above it. Vengeance is mine. And God, I want the power to speak to my future. And somebody shout a great big amen. I was with Joel Osteen Monday night. He was at our minister's meeting. And it's a fellowship I started many years ago. And now... Pastor Kent is the president of it, and so Joel was there, and many, many, many great preachers, and so Joel was talking. He wasn't preaching to us. He was just telling us about how he got to where he is today with the influence, and everywhere you go. I call him my Billy Graham, and if you get on the internet, you'll see the religious world, they despise Joel, and evidently, because he has a way of forgiving sinners. And I'll sit next to somebody on the plane, and invariably when I pull my Bible out, they will start talking and saying, do you know the smiley guy on TV from Texas? And I will tell them, I know Joel Osteen. Is he as real as I sense that when I look on television behind the scenes? I said, he's that real. He's that forgiving. He was telling us all the things on Google and all the things that people come after him in Victoria. All the things they're critical of, and all the, just stacks and stacks. He said, you look on the internet and they'll say, I'm buying Ferraris. And he said Monday night to all of us, I've never even sat in a Ferrari. The fact is that he was telling us, I have to forgive the lies. I have to forgive those that will not seek forgiveness. Jesus gives the order of forgiveness. Go to that one. Go to that one and see if they will forgive you. If they don't forgive you, the responsibility is no longer yours. All you can do is say, I'm sorry. I should have never done that. And when you do that, God then empowers you that you will have the power to speak to your future. I'm reminded of Apostle Paul. I love the 26th chapter of the book of Acts. Here is a man of God slain on the Damascus Road. Here is a man that God calls who is a killer of Christians. Here's a man that writes most of the New Testament and literally starts churches in the Corinth and the Philippi and Ephesus. And I mean, he is shaking the world. Right before he goes to Rome, which is at the end of his ministry, and he is shaking the world, and the Bible says he turned the world upside down. He's in Jerusalem, and when he's in Jerusalem, the Bible says that the religious people wanted to kill Paul. He escapes them and goes down a little way from Jerusalem, and he finds himself in the hands of Governor Festus. And the Bible says that Festus then puts him in prison. And now Paul is in prison. He's done nothing wrong. Don't you feel sometimes when you have done nothing wrong, but yet you are imprisoned by somebody who says you have done wrong? Anybody know what I'm talking about? And you're wondering why I am in this position. 1 month goes by, 2 months goes by. If you read good history, it will really thrill you to know that Festus, the governor, was entertained by Paul, bring him up out of prison. He would eat with him. He loved Paul's mind. Paul was a great debater. He was so intelligent. He debated even on Mars Hill with the wisest of philosophers, and he could keep up with them. Paul was brilliant. He was so brilliant and entertaining with his history, his knowledge, and of course the revelation of Jesus Christ. Festus looks at him, and Paul says, please, look, I'm a Roman citizen. You've kept me in prison. I'm in these chains for 3 months. Please get me an audience with the king. I know you know the king, King Agrippa. Please, I just need to talk to him. Is there any way? Festus says, I'll do everything I possibly can. Puts him back into prison 5 months, 7 months, 8 months, 12 months. We're talking about Paul the apostle. He's there. He hasn't done one thing. He's there for a year and 2 months. Finally, they come down and said, he has arranged for the king of Israel, Agrippa, to see you. The fanfare is there. The trumpets are blown. The bodyguards, the red carpet, the throne is set up. And now Paul is going to get to come out of prison. The Bible says he's in chains. King Agrippa is on his throne. Bodyguards are everywhere. The fanfare is unbelievable. The king is here. And now he is going to hear Paul's testimony. And King Agrippa, the Bible says in the 26th chapter of Acts, he looks at Paul standing in front of him and says, Paul, what do you have to say for yourself? Now listen to this. Paul, the first thing that comes out of his mind, he says, King, I think myself happy. Let me just tell everybody here today, he had to forgive everybody to get to the position he could think himself happy. Quit being tormented. Quit carrying somebody else's sin. Quit carrying somebody else's murmuring or complaining or gossip. Set yourself free and say, I cut the chains and I forgive and cast it into the sea. I think myself happy. How many happy people we have here today? Just clap your hands all over. Forgiveness is so powerful that Jesus exclamates it and says, look, if you live by the 490 rule, how fast can you forgive the man that cuts in front of you on the Bishop Ford or on your street? How quick are you to get angry, scream, say some things, or how quick can you say, I forgive you. I forgive you. Every day of our life, we are going to face offenses. But I'm here to tell you, you got a God in heaven that says, if you will say, I'm sorry, if you will say, Lord, forgive me, God will hear every prayer. And the Bible says anything that touches his anointing, the Bible says he'll deal with it. Don't play God, play the part of forgiveness. I forgive you. I forgive you. Somebody shouted, I forgive you. Your children are gonna do stuff. Your husband's gonna do stuff. Your wife is gonna do stuff. Your cousins are gonna do stuff. Leaders in your community are gonna do stuff. Nothing is new. There is a surprise every day of our life. But I refuse to carry the ugly rumors of anybody's sin. I didn't die for him. My blood cannot cover them. But I can say, Jesus, forgive them as you forgave me. And when I forgive, I have the power to speak. I have the power to bind. I have the power to loose. I think she's going to be 30. Help me. She's going to be 30. She's going to be 30 in a few days. So Candy, Melody, and I's daughter gets pregnant. We find her in the abortion clinic. Son, instead of Melly and I holding a sign up picketing, we went in. I said to Candy, don't kill this baby. I'll raise it. I'll resign the church if everybody's embarrassed. Never forget, on 1300 North Broad Street that morning, I got up and said, my daughter's pregnant. I've asked her to carry the baby. I'm going to support it. I'm going to love it. At 1300 North Broad Street, Melody was there. I said, I know you need a perfect preacher. I understand that. I know you're embarrassed, but Candy's over in the overflow and she's showing, so I just want you to know that she's my daughter and I'm going to stand. So I understand if you need another preacher. I understand, because you probably find somebody better, more holy. So I just want you to know that I'm going to give this church up for my daughter not killing the baby. And I got a standing ovation. I think we were having two services at that time. And people, the services stopped, and people were pulling on my suit, and I'm sure they were pulling on Melody. I felt like I was being pulled apart by people. With tears in their eyes, I said, now you know what we're going through, and we would rather follow someone who knows the pain that we're going through. Because anybody that can forgive, it's a person we want to follow. And Chantel Munsey will be 30 years old in just a few days. Shay Lee is my new secretary. She's my granddaughter. She went to Barry University and now going to SEU, finishing up her education. And she's so good. So I was preaching at the largest prison in Indiana, Westville. It's a big, right? Did I say it right? I said, we had a big tent. See, 2000, and all the prisoners came out and they had me to speak. Mike Barber was putting it together. He wanted me to speak. Actually, I have to tell you something. I was smoking all over the world on television, big conference churches, whatever. But I'll tell you, man, I was petrified in front of 2,000 prisoners. Not that they would kill me, but what could I say to them? I never forget, I preached Jose and Gomer. I did story time. At the end, 2,000 prisoners stand to their feet. They then sit down. I ask, who would like to be saved? Somebody said there was 1,800, 1,900 that stood up for salvation. I'm not quite sure. The warden said, Reverend, before you go, before we dismiss all these men, I was sweating, got done with the message, gave the altar call. You can't allow the prisoners to come up. All the guards are around. The warden said, there's a man here. He really wants to talk to you. And before I dismiss him, do you mind if he comes? There'll be guards around him. So I'm standing in front of over 2,000 prisoners. Just got them preaching. I'm drenched in sweat. It's under the tent. Must have been 100 degrees underneath there. So they bring up this young man. Tears are coming down his face. I gave my life to Jesus today. Great. I said, what's your name? He told me his name. Then with tears coming down his face, he says, how's Shay Lee? I said, how do you know Shay Lee? He said, because I'm her daddy. And all 2,000, they didn't hear the conversation, but they were staring right at us. I began to weep. I said, I forgive you. He looked at the warden. He said, warden, can I hug him? I looked at the warden and said, can I hug him back? When anybody ask me, how come this? How come that? It's not because I'm perfect, but I have learned the 490 rule. Forgive. I forgive your sons and daughters. I forgive all the marriages. I forgive mistakes. I'm probably so full of grace that somebody probably wants to beat me over the head and say, how can you love that much? But I'm going to tell you, I've learned, and I'm still learning. Don't let the offense. I think myself happy. And I forgive. Do I have anybody else here today? Stand to your feet and clap your hands to God for the forgiveness power. To attach yourself to an offense only makes you become like the offender. You will be attracted to those that are also offended. Your crowd is called bitterness. Your crowd is called get even. Your crowd is destruction. Your crowd is angry. Because spirits attract spirits. I'm so glad we've all been attracted to the one who has forgiven us all. Come on, give him a big hand. It's all right. It's a big hand. Singers, take your place. Come on, big hand. Forgive us. And I've learned if I carry that offense, which is unforgiveness, it's like poison and it's killing me, my health, my life. But today, he said, I will forgive you, but I want you to do the 490, forgive everyone else. Then I will give you the power. I promise I'll give you the power. Speak to every mountain. Declare the righteousness of God upon your life. Cast demons out in the name of Jesus.
When Jesus said to forgive 490 times in one day, 7 times 70 in one day, I want to reach out with these words to you. In some cases, it's very, very hard. But when you forgive, you let that situation and person go. The moment you do that, you free yourself into a supernatural environment of God listening to your words of faith. If one, as you heard today, does not forgive, and I know we're quick to say, but you don't know what my dad did to me, you don't know what my, you know, relative did to me, you don't know what that person did to me, and it was hurtful, it hurt me, he, she hurt me. Let it go, forgive them. It immediately puts you in the category in which, as he taught us, if you forgive them, then I will forgive you, meaning I will listen to your prayer. Think about where you are. Is it worth the grudge? Is it worth the gossip? Is it worth the anger? Is it worth the feelings of unforgiveness toward that person? Let it go today, and I pray right now. I'm not saying it's easy. I don't think Jesus is saying to us it's easy. But if we let it go, the prayer of what you're believing for will be answered. Jesus says, if you don't forgive, I cannot hear your prayer. And Satan is on purpose trying to get you in a position not to forgive. Father, in the name of Jesus, if I were you, and I want you to say, Lord Jesus, forgive me. And forgive, I forgive that person. Today it's over, I'm going to forgive. Now, you're unhandcuffed from that situation and God's getting ready to do great miracles in your life, the 490 rule. Today, I am passionate about the schools of the Chicagoland area. I personally believe that if you will go to a school and lay your hand on that school, and you don't have to ask the principal, just drive up, get out of your car, and go and lay your hand on that school, because I'm looking for people who pray for schools. And here is the prayer. Lay your hand on the school and say, Lord Jesus, let there not be one shooting in this school this year. Lord, let there be no violence in this school. And then pray, Lord, let there be peace. Let peace angels go into the hallways and guard this school. Lord, let this school experience your Holy Spirit. You lay your hand on that school. I'm looking for you to do that. Now, here's what I want you to do, if you will. And I'm asking passionately. So if you do that to any school, private, daycare, public, religious, go to the website and say, Steve Munsey, I prayed for this school. I then will take the name of that school, I do need the name of the school, And I'm going to write personally the president, the principal, the head of that school, and tell them you prayed. And then we're going to pray. We're going to pray as a church, as a body. The 600 schools that we prayed for last year did not have one shooting. We are looking to believe there will be 1,500 schools this year, but I need your help. Will you do that this week? Praise God. That's good. We need to pray for our schools. God, I thank you today that everyone has watched. And Lord, if somebody's watching right now and they want to call and say, you know, I just want to pray the prayer of forgiveness. Or Lord, they may even want to pray, Lord, I'm going to pray that I forgive that person. And in the name of Jesus, as we're praying right now, the number's on the screen. Call us. We're here live. If you want someone to pray with you to say, help me, I want to pray because I've had a grudge against this person and I've disliked that person and I haven't forgiven them. Would you pray with me? And would you pray right now? Call that number on the screen. We're standing by. I believe you're about to get the biggest miracle in your life because you have obeyed the 490 rule that Jesus taught us. Well, I just want to tell you, until next time, yes, you can.
Operators are standing by. The number is on your screen. Steve Munsey wants to pray for you today.
Family Christian Center has committed passionately to pray for schools. What we do is we ask our eldership, we ask people who are members. Now I'm going beyond. I'm asking you. So if, say this was a school and I was walking up to the school, and what you would do is you would touch the school like this. Say this is the door. And you would just touch the school like this. And you would say, Lord Jesus, I anoint this school. No shootings in this school, Lord. I am praying no shootings. Lord, I am praying no violence. Lord, I am praying that angels go into this school during the school year. And I anoint this school and believe. In the name of Jesus, peace angels will be in this school. I need the name of that school because what we're going to do is you submit the name of that school, go right to our website and give us that name of the school and then your name. Then I will write the principal, the president of a daycare, grade school, private school, Christian school, public school, but I need your help. Last year we had 600 schools. We are believing for 1,500 schools to be prayed for. And every school we prayed for, there was no shooting. Do that today. Thank you.
Make plans to join us next week at the same time.